Oh, Shaddai, bless you guys, my family, friends. I kind of dressed up today. I shaved. All in hopes that you give me more grace because I'm going to be a little bit more bolder with you than normal. More brutally honest than normal. So hopefully the tie, and if I had a podium in front of me, then I can get away with a lot more. Wink, wink. I wish sarcasm was a gift of the Holy Spirit, so Lord, forgive me. But I think y'all need to hear this, some of you. I've had my best deliverance of the week that I've had, like, geez, a bunch of firsts that I've never had had experienced before. And then I've had one of my worst deliverances this week. You guys ever watch that show Intervention on A&E? I love that show because it really has a lot to do with deliverance. You know, being demonized and addicted to drugs, pretty much the same thing. It is the same thing. So in the show, we see people who are addicted, let's say addicted to meth. They lose their kids, they lose their homes, they lose their jobs, they lose their houses, they're on the streets, they're selling their body. They're doing horrendous things to get the next fix. They lost their teeth, they lost their health, right? But still yet, they still are, I'm going to do it my way. Even in Revelation, we see some of the plagues, you know, coming down and people still raise a fist to God. So the family comes in, surprises the meth addict and says, look, we're going to cut you off even more so. We're not going to give you rides to your pimp. We're not going to, you know, we're not going to give you drug money. We're not going to provide a hotel room so you can hook out of, you know. So you either choose rehab or you're really, really on your own. At that moment, that allows them to hit bottom. And then they are able to have that moment of clarity and be like, oh yeah, I guess I should go change my life. Because I've been doing it my way, right? I've been doing it my way. And it just doesn't work. I get more addicted. I get more diseases. I get more things going wrong in my life. I get more demons. If that drug addict, even if they're, okay, I need to say this correctly. If they're even suicidal, that doesn't necessarily mean that they've hit bottom. Because suicide is the ultimate form of control. You're still taking your life, your God-given, blood-bought, Jesus blood-bought life into your own hands, and you're saying, I'm going to take it away. I choose to leave this earth prematurely. I mean, that really is the ultimate form of control. So you still have not given up. Now, if somebody's suicidal, they say they're suicidal, you need to take that seriously and just be like, oh, you probably haven't hit bottom. No, you need to take that seriously, okay? Don't mistake me for what I'm saying. In my own life, I was suicidal, but yet I still didn't hit bottom. I think it was like the third time I was suicidal that I was like, you know what? Out of all the decisions I've made, choosing to live my life the way I want to live it, and I was living after God, what I thought was after God, it still was my way. And the most powerful prayer that I prayed, I think in quite a while, maybe if not ever, was I give up. I give. God, I've done it my way. It's led me to ruin. It's led me to despair. It's led me to depression. It's led me to ruin. I give up. I truly now give my life to you because you're smarter than me, you're more powerful than I am, and you want the best for me. I give up, I give up, I give up. At that moment, God delivered me a measure, okay? There was a veil that was taken off, and I finally seen, yeah, you're demonized. You need to go get deliverance, a full deliverance this time, not just playing, you know, a counseling session where it's 4 hours long and they only cast out two demons. You need to get fully delivered. And so I sought that path. Even had to bypass, you know, a pastor telling me that demons were an excuse. I just wanted to blame something for my problems. It's crazy. So anyways, found my deliverance. I'm a new man. Found my destiny. Can hear God's voice now. Before, I always struggled with it. I'm no longer sexually addicted. I'm no longer in the miry clay. You know, it's nice. It's nice. It really is nice. And I love delivering other Christians and calling them up a few days afterwards. Hey, how's it going? Oh yeah, man, I haven't felt like this in 20 years. You know, I've never felt like this. You know, I can finally stop taking the drugs. And I haven't taken the drugs yet. And I mean, it's just awesome. And then you call them a month or two from now, and they're sending me pictures. And, you know, this is what I look like before. This is what I look like now. God's healed me. It's awesome. It's awesome. And talking to a demonized person, maybe that's you right now, it's kind of trying to describe Disneyland when you've only lived in an attic your whole life. It's hard to describe. And if you're a Christian that feels spirit-led to let me know that Christians can't have demons, in the comments section, I need you to write what you do for a living on a day-to-day basis. And then I'm going to comment back and say, you know, like, let's say you say, well, I work at a pet shop. And I'll say, well, I don't believe in dog food. And then you'll be like, well, I'm a teacher. And I say, I don't believe in students or desks or pencils. So it's kind of insulting, isn't it? So I do this on a day-to-day basis. People are Christians. I know they're Christians, and they're delivered and they're free. So either I'm a liar or your theology is way off and it's keeping you from your freedom, period. There is no middle ground. If that addict is sent to rehab and they haven't hit bottom, they're going to go through detox. That's like one of the first things they go through, and that's living hell for them. So if they're double-minded and say, you know what, I was going to get free by myself and I just needed maybe a couple more months to do it, and they were double-minded, do you think when they're going through hell, do you think when they're going through the shakes and throwing up their guts and having hallucinations and they can't sleep and they have their heads throbbing, you know what I'm saying? Do you think they're going to survive that if they're double-minded and they're saying, you know what, I really had an opportunity to get free on my own? James 1, but let him ask in faith nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Or I love the drug. I don't want to get off. I'm going to die with a crack pipe. That's the way I want to die. You know, if you force them to rehab, they're not going to follow the program. They have to say, I give up. I've done it my way. I've been trying to do it my way for decades and I haven't changed. Nothing new results, but it just keeps on getting worse. I give up. I submit to the program. I submit to rehab. That's the only way they're going to get through it, because when they're throwing up their guts, they can say, this is the only way. I've tried it other ways. This is the only way. So you can't be double-minded. You're going to say, well, you're not Jesus Christ. Why do I have to submit to you to get delivered? Well, I don't have a magic wand. You know what I'm saying? This isn't my ministry where I just say some voodoo words over you and sprinkle some pixie dust and poof, you're good to go. Where do you think the power comes from to deliver you of your demons? Where do you think the power comes from to heal you of your sicknesses and diseases? It comes from El Shaddai. It comes from God Almighty. And so if you're double-minded, God Almighty doesn't honor that. And so I'm a conduit. And so if God Almighty isn't providing the power, then me being a conduit doesn't matter at all, because there's no power coming through me. Amen? And if you're prideful, God resists the proud. So again, there's no power coming through me. Your demons are being like, there's no power coming through this dude, so I'm not going to manifest. I'm going to stay chill. It's comfy here. I don't want to leave. If you're rebellious, same thing. If you're lazy and slothful, and you can't even watch the videos to even find out what I'm doing in the deliverance session, name me one other time in your life that you're lazy, prideful, resentful, double-minded, unbelief, didn't have any faith, and God honored you, and God showed mightily on your behalf. James 4, do you think that the scripture saith in vain, the spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth to envy? But he gives more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but gives grace unto the humble. Submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. Even the demoniac fell to his knees and said, Lord, have mercy. He recognized he was demonized, right? He was hit bottom, living in the tombs, cutting himself. I think the dude hit bottom. That's a prerequisite for God's mercy and grace. When God sent out the 70, it was a prerequisite for that city to even invite them into their homes. If they didn't invite them in their homes, the Bible says to shake your dust off your feet and it'd be more tolerable for Sodom than that city on Judgment Day. When Jesus Christ was walking through the crowds, people were touching him left and right. But it was only the female who said, in her heart, I've tried everywhere else. I've tried all the other doctors to get free from this issue of blood. And even though I'm going to defile him, even though it's against Jewish law, and I could get hurt for this or punished, or I'm not sure if they got stoned for that, but I'm going to touch this man of God because I believe he's the Son of God. I know I have issues, but my faith is going to draw from his power. Only if I could touch his hem. And power was drawn from Jesus. And Jesus, what? He said, you know, who touched me? And about disciples saying, like, everybody's touching you. So how come not everybody got the power of God? Everybody was touching him. So archangel, you're not Jesus Christ. I don't need to submit to you. I am the ambassador of Jesus Christ. I don't have a magic wand. If you feel like you're not demonized, it's not my job or my responsibility to prove to you that you're demonized. If you have four mental diseases, you're addicted to pharmaceuticals, you have an addiction and compulsion and obsessions, Jesus Christ didn't pay for that. I don't care what you say. I don't care if you say that, you know, when I'm weak, God is strong. Jesus Christ didn't pay for that. Jesus Christ became a curse for us so we don't have to be a curse. So the generational curses are broken. We can break that, but we have to break it. Isaiah 53:5, he paid for our peace. He paid when he was being whipped, he was paying for our diseases. We don't have to carry that. Now, if you're rebellious and you open the doors to the enemy, or, you know, God can't get through you any other way and you're going to the pit of hell, yeah, God is going to use everything in his arsenal to get your attention. But once you repent and come to God and ask for forgiveness or forgive somebody, because unforgiveness is a huge door, then the consequences of the sins are taken care of. You know, God chastens us. You chasten your children because you love them. You know, sorry, Dad, for rebelling. I come back. What do you want me to do? I give. You know, what do you want me to do? I'll be a good boy. Do you think the dad continues to chasten him until he dies? No. If he sins and he gets a consequence that, you know, hurts him, when he repents, does that consequence have to stay with him forever? No. If you had sex and you get AIDS, when you repent for having sex, do you have to die with AIDS? No. God is the Redeemer. That's who he is. He redeems everything. That's his job. That's his role. That's his responsibility. You will be healed of AIDS if and only if you repent of the original sin that brought in AIDS in your life. It's not God's heart or choice to say, okay, you sinned, but now you repent, but I still want to kill you. Yeah, you've forgiven. Yeah, you've repented. Yeah, you humbled yourself. But, you know, you really need to die of AIDS. It doesn't work like that, guys. That's the devil wanting to kill you. That's the devil telling you that you need to die. That's his job. Okay, so you need to say, I give, all right? You need to be desperate. You at least need to know you're demonized. If you don't know you're demonized, why are you trying to contact a deliverance minister? So I need you to finish out what you think is going to give you freedom. But I'm asking you to not take too much longer on it, especially if you've done it for decades and you're still addicted, still obsessed, still compulsed, still in control, still prideful. But if you feel like this road that, you know, this teaching, this person you're following, whatever's going on, you know, follow it out, but don't take too long and don't pick up demons on the way. Don't go into Eastern meditation and New Age and hypnotism, all that garbage that actually gives you more demons, because you blank out as the gatekeeper and you say, hey, whatever comes in, because you at least need to know you're demonized, because once we go through the deliverance session, you're going to get attacked, okay? These demons want their ground back, and they're going to come back in force and say, look, we want it back. You're going to get attacked. You're going to get lied to. They're going to pull all the strings that they've been pulling your whole life. They're going to have you run out the door. They're going to have you say, look, you got to get away from this guy. You got to turn this guy off now. Run away from him. Run as far away from him as you can. Or just pinpoint one thing that he said and see, look, this guy isn't a god. This guy's a total loon. You know, the enemy's smart. He's smarter than you and I. They've been doing this for thousands of years. They know how to steal, kill, and destroy like you know how to make peanut butter and jelly. They're good at it, okay? So understand that. So when you come to a deliverance session, know that you're in a war zone. Know that I'm taking you into a war zone, all right? There are no visitors on the front lines. There are no tourists on the front lines. If you're on the front lines, you're either there to kill the enemy or die trying. Okay, there's no middle ground. There is no middle ground. Because once you're being manipulated by the demon, especially confusion, unbelief in the beginning of the session, it's kind of rough in the beginning part of the session, because the demons are posturing, they're mocking, they're cursing, they're threatening. It's all in hopes that you stop and so they can stay. But if you realize you're demonized, if you realize that you've done it your way and it hasn't worked, then when that stuff happens, you're able to fight through it and say, you know what? I submit to the process. I'm going to go through it. I don't care what happens. I'm going to go through it. It's not like rehab. You're not throwing up it's actually, some of them are kind of peaceful. It depends on how your heart is. It depends on how... depends if you believe in the truth. It depends on how your relationship with God is. It depends on, do you even know how to fight? It depends on a lot of things. There's so many variables that I really can't get into. It depends on what kind of demons you have. Are they prideful demons? Are they rebellious demons? Or are they just lying spirits? Are they blasphemy demons? It really depends on the demon of how the deliverance session goes. How many do you have? How much fortification the demons have inside you? Sometimes as you get in the session, the demons are like, yep, I'm here. Yep, yeah, can I go? This week I've had my best deliverance and I've had my worst deliverance. So let's talk about my best deliverance. He's giving me permission to talk about it. He has a big destiny, okay? So he had three kingdoms of demons that were just there just to blind him from his destiny, to distract him. One was mind blindness, confusion, destiny destroyer. These are their words, you know. So he had three kingdoms all targeted to blind him from his destiny, to stop him from being who he is in Jesus Christ fully. And I just want to take a side note. There's some Christians out there that say, oh, God delivered me of this and this and this. I've been delivered cigarettes and drunkenness. And I mean, praise Jesus. Awesome. You know, that's great. But don't you want to know if you're fully delivered? Because there's demons out there. You might not be addicted to anything, but there's demons out there that are blocking your faith. There's demons out there that are blocking your destiny. Don't you want to make sure that they're not there? I don't know. It says cast off every weight and run the race. So I don't know. If you want to say, hey, you know, I had two demons knocked out of me and I'm good to go. And in my experience, you either have between nine and like 15 kingdoms in every single Christian. So, you know, it's your choice. It's your choice. You're only hurting the kingdom. So I had a lot of firsts in this deliverance. He had some pretty big holy angels, I believe. And so even before I was even able to cast them out, these demons were going. These demons were casting themselves out, which was a first. Another first was there's a pretty big demon. You know, if you ever watched the movie Placebo, there's like animal types, and in the worksheet in the videos I show you that we ask the demons, what kind of animal are they? How would we describe them? And some of them are like half breeds, some of them are like boars, lions, snakes, bats, just whatever. And but when you come across a demon that says he's a human warrior type, you're probably talking to like a principality. You're talking to a pretty big, powerful demon. Nothing to be afraid of, but you need to listen to me. Read Jude, okay? when it says those filthy dreamers, they speak evil of dignities and dominion. And that's talking about angels, okay? They speak of evil against things that they do not understand. They're naturally brute beasts, and they speak evil of the spiritual realm, and they don't even understand it, okay? It says there's spots in your feast. This isn't a good description of these people, okay? And it says, even Michael the archangel didn't bring a reviling accusation against Satan. He said, Lord, rebuke you. So even Michael the archangel didn't slander the devil, okay? Some deliverance ministers want to provoke the demons to get them to manifest. You know, like, oh, come on, you pride, you know, why don't you brag about all the things that you've done, you know, just to have them manifest. You may get away with that with smaller demons, but when you are dealing with the principalities or wickedness in high places, you know, the hierarchy, you need to respect them. You need to stay underneath the authority of Jesus Christ, stay underneath his wing, and you need to respect the enemy. Oh, archangel, what do you mean respect them? I hate them. There's, you know, if I threw you in a lion's cage, you would respect the lion. No difference. For some reason, I don't know what I said or what I did, but I overstepped my authority when I was dealing with that demon. And it was like, you know, I'm coming for you. You know, and I guess later it says, you know, I'm going to choke the crap out of you. You know, and there was fear that rose up. You know, I had to fight it. And I'm like, no, in name of Jesus Christ, you know, holy angels, you need to, you know, this demon is threatening the ambassador of Jesus Christ. You know, I had to fight it right then. But anyways, that demon ended up coming to me at night and stopped my breathing while I slept about 20 times. I basically like had sleep apnea, and I've never had that before. And then he was on my heart doing stuff with my heart. So I had to repent. I had to go to the Father and say, Lord, forgive me for my pride and for slandering this demon. I overstepped my bounds. Lord, please forgive me. And I cast out the demon, and I'm healed. So that's another first, okay? So if you're in this ministry, you may get away with provoking the smaller demons, but I'll just be on the safe side. We're just here for business, okay? They know that they can't trespass on a child of God. And if they have legal right, they need to confess what that is, to give the child of God an opportunity to confess, repent, humble themselves, and then cast out the demon, okay? We don't need to be slandering these demons. We don't need to be mocking them. We don't need to be overstepping our bounds, okay? We need to respect them. They are smarter than us. They are more powerful than us in the human, you know, realm. But yes, we've been given all power over the enemy to tread on serpents and scorpions. But yet that power is when we follow the rules. Okay. If we overstep our rules, then we're open targets. So that was another first. When dealing with this powerful demon, he said, oh, he's mine. You know, you can't have him. Leave me alone. Who are you? You know, but he's mine. And so when a demon says he's mine, you need to say, look at his seal. Look at the seal that God gave him, the Holy Spirit seal. Who does he belong to? And the demon was manifesting through this Christian. And so he was like, you know, I can't, it burns me. And I said, you look at that seal named Jesus Christ. Well, who does he belong to? And the demon said, the Lamb of God. Demons don't like to say that stuff, okay? Because they just admitted that he doesn't belong to them. So that's pretty neat. So even him looking at the seal of God burned him. So that was pretty neat. So that was a first. There's some other firsts. Oh, yeah, he had demons in the thousands, okay? Because he had a big destiny and there's more demons on him. But on the same token, so that was a record of mine. On the same token, he was delivered probably in an hour and 50 minutes. So that's another record. Anyways, the most powerful prayer you guys can pray is I give up. Okay. Lord, is there anywhere in my life where I still have control, where I'm still trying to bring revenge to somebody, that I'm still trying to control my finances, I'm still trying to control my safety, I'm still trying to control my future? Lord, I give up. That's the most powerful prayer you can pray. And my power to help deliver you doesn't come from a magic wand. It comes from God. So the same rules apply. If you want deliverance, I'm just a conduit. You're not submitting to me, y'all. You're submitting to the power that's coming through me, which is God. So submit, humble yourself, repent, Forgive. Be obedient. I don't have any other ulterior motives. I'm not here to lord it over you. I'm here to train you, to have you stand on my shoulders and go out there and deliver your friends and family and your sphere of influence. I have no ulterior motives. I don't ask for money. I just want you guys free, okay? And I try not to take this personally, but it's hard not to because I'm spending hours with you. I'm knowing your deepest, darkest secrets. I'm on the war zone. I'm on the front lines for you. Your demons are beating me up. It's hard not to take this personally, you know? And then you tell me that you don't believe that you have any demons, and I'm looking at your questionnaire, and you're addicted to 10 different things. You know, sometimes the demons win, you know? I know I like to be a rah-rah guy, you know, go get them, but I'll admit, some deliverances are failures, you know? And if the demons don't answer me and the Holy Spirit isn't answering me, I'm not a mind reader, you know? So I believe too that when you go through a deliverance, there's a huge layer that's taken off, but that huge layer is like rebellion, pride, confusion, unbelief. I mean, these are huge things that stop you from your relationship with God, from even hearing his voice. And so maybe we didn't get through all the demons, but this, with this new layer taken off, you're able to go home and like have this new relationship with God that you've never had before. Have the Holy Spirit talk to you and speak to you and teach you and bring you to a new level of understanding and confidence and trust in God. And so maybe when he reveals the next layer, it's some deep, dark stuff in there that maybe you pushed down and forgot all about, and like some nasty stuff, like, you know, your mom molested you or something crappy, you know? And so God needs to raise that relationship with you, because when you do realize that, then your faith in God is already there. And so when you hear that, God's right there. Jesus Christ is right there healing you just almost as instantly as you're hearing the information. So I believe that. I believe that, you know, sometimes I believe that maybe you're 80% done, but the Holy Spirit's saying, yeah, he's good to go for now, you know. And then you go home, you're faithful with that. You thank God for, even if there's one demon that was cast out or you forgave one person or whatever, you need to thank God for that. Thank Jesus for that. Stand in that faith, stand in that thanksgiving and praise, and you know, God will move you to the next level if you're faithful with the little, right? We go back to the same thing. And then he'll move then we'll get the next layer out. So we're always, the closer we get to God, we're always revealing new lies, new religious garbage, new things, theologies that are stopping us, stopping the power of God. Anyways, I love you. Pray I give, one of the most powerful prayers a man or woman can pray. I love you. God bless you.